Okay. Show me.
Hi there, guys. Welcome back to the Dutch Sheet Channel. Thank you very much for tuning in. And I've got me a box from Ditone. It contains the Roma F4LR long range. Yeah, so if you've been following my channel, you might have noticed that I've tried and tried to resist this long range hype. Is it a hype? Yeah, probably a bit of a hype. But okay, I couldn't resist. I like the photos of this quadcopter so much. Also, Ditone is one of my favorite brands, as you probably know. So yeah, I just couldn't resist. In fact, it's even worse. I've got me this ready to fly, or well, plug and fly version of the Roma F4. I also have the frame, so I'll be building a second one, a different one to try things. Okay, in this video we're gonna take a look at the quadcopter in this box. Obviously, it is a plug and fly, and in a separate video I'll do a frame review. That might be interesting to see, well, what the options are with this frame itself. So, this is also a bit of a different boxing style from Ditone. All their previous, or most of their previous boxes were white. This one is actually more of a box within a paper sleeve, and it's hard to get it out, so it's actually okay. Maybe it was just the first time that was hard. Okay, so in this video I'm gonna show you what I got for my money. We're gonna do two flights as well. We're gonna do a line of sight flight, mostly to gauge what it flies like, if it's a powerful, probably not, but how peppy it is. And we'll do some FPV flying as well, my maiden FPV flight with this quadcopter. So let's see what we have here. We've got a bit of a documentation. What is this? Okay, about the placement of the FPV antenna. Okie doke. We got, okay, that's not included actually. This is a receiver I'll be using. We've got cables to attach a receiver, either an RXSR receiver or any SBUS receiver this cable set is useful for. And we've got some more documentation about the electronics in this quadcopter. We've got one of these general purpose action camera mounts. Well, two actually, a platform. And yeah, plastic and not 3D printed, but this is the action cam mount Ditone nowadays ships with their quadcopters. We've got one set of propellers and HQ propellers, two bladed 4-inch obviously propellers. We've got, what is this? Frame assembly, okay. Well, this is a buy and fly, so the frame is already screwed together, but in case you want to do maintenance on your copter, this can be handy, especially if you're new to FPV quadcopters. And we've got a parts list, which is definitely handy. Then we've got a care package. Quite a lot in this care package actually. We'll take a close look in a second. And we've got the quadcopter, which was actually zip tied into the box. You can hopefully see that over here, but I've already taken off those zip ties. Okay, let's get rid of the box and see what we actually have. So that first pamphlet I took out of the box is actually about the VTX, or the video transmitter antenna. And you see that here, it is strapped, tie wrapped to the frame. You obviously snip that tie wrap off and then press the antenna into the back of the quadcopter. If it would have been mounted to the back already, it wouldn't have fit in the box. But this is obviously not the way you're gonna fly the quadcopter. Theoretically you could, but that's not so yeah, you take a plier and you snip off this here zip tie, and then you go and press the antenna into the back over here. You actually press it into a TPU printed mount. It also houses the GPS antenna, as you can see over here, and it's got some mountings for mounts for tube antenna tubes, which I will actually use. And so actually a close look at the quadcopter itself in a second. Let's take a close look again at that care package to see what we actually have here. Quite a lot this time. We get a lot of zip ties. And do we actually need those zip ties? I don't even think so. Maybe if you want to mount your antennas, your receiver antennas somewhere else on the frame. But other than that, I don't even think we need. But zip ties are obviously always handy to have, so thank you very much. We get, again, like I mentioned, two antenna tubes. And I will be using those because I will be using a 2.4 GHz antenna. We get one battery or camera strap. And we get another of those. These are probably camera straps. And this will then be the battery strap, a wider strap. Very nice. And this is, in case you are unfamiliar with diatones, diatone quadcopters, this is usual for a diatone quadcopter. You get a full set, a full complement of spare screws for the frame. Very nice. We get... These are probably screws to mount your propellers, because that's the way you mount the propellers that are meant for the quadcopter. We get a buzzer, which is again also usual for a diatone quadcopter. You do get a buzzer, but it's not mounted to the quadcopter, in case you want to save weight. But well, if you do want the buzzer, then you can mount it. You get some antenna caps or antenna tube caps for these plastic tubes. And we get, this will be very hard to see for you, but mounting platforms, 20 by 20 and 16 by 16 mounting platforms. Receiver or, well, mostly for a receiver, I guess. Yeah, okay, very, very nice. And we get one anti-slip mat for your battery, which you obviously stick onto the top of the quadcopter. So guys, as you may or may not know, diatones never come with a receiver. That might actually change, or might, that will, that will actually change in the near future. They'll be offering this actually quadcopter with a receiver shortly. But, well, this one I have here comes without a receiver, and again, most diatones will in fact come without a receiver. But they will also always come with this here wire set, which is... soldered onto the flight controller, as you can see here. It is soldered onto, let's see, TX and RX1. So, and with that, you can use this pigtail, this wire, for an RXSR receiver, or an XM Plus, or any SBUS receiver, or a crossfire receiver. And the documentation that comes with the copter actually shows you how to hook that up. So that's pretty easy. You also get this pigtail for an RXSR. It actually says RXSR. So it has two connectors. One of the connectors hooks up to this wire over here, and the other one to your receiver. So that's very easy, no soldering required. If you have any other SBUS receiver or a crossfire receiver, you'll have to solder this wire that also comes with a quadcopter to that receiver, which is what I'll be doing. Right, I have an XM Plus receiver, which I'll use for the quadcopter. And by now, I actually have my receiver installed in the quadcopter, as you can tell. I ended up not using the connectors that came on the quadcopter. This, I snipped this one off. This looks a little cleaner, but I definitely could have used that connector. It's easy to install your receiver like that. So what you also see is this TPU part over here, which... houses or mounts your receiver, or rather you can mount your receiver in that TPU print. Pretty nifty. And yes, if you are familiar with iFlight copters, especially their 5-inch quadcopters, you recognize this design. Yeah, have they stolen a design from iFlight? Well, yeah. Inspiration. Okay, so this TPU print here, you've got your antennas mounted to it, and also your FPV antenna at the rear, and your receiver. You don't need zip ties or anything. Your receiver just slots in there, and that's it. Very, very nice and clean. Also, the configuration was already set up for SBUS, So if you use Crossfire, you'll have to change that. Speaking of, let's take a close look at the configuration of this quadcopter. So the Betaflight configuration, right? Let's see what they did with that. Alright guys, Betaflight. Let's have a looky. We'll hook up the quadcopter. And there we go. Okay, I have already taken a quick peek. And in fact, I've changed two things, which I will mention shortly. And in fact, the first change is in the ports tab. Oh, and the stock Betaflight firmware is 4.1.3. Hope you'll be able to see that over here in the top left corner. 4.1.3, not the latest version, but it'll do just fine. And I will be testing the quadcopter as is with this Betaflight version. Now, ports tab. I have the analog version, right? So the digital, DJI digital version will look a little different. I'm not sure at which UART they would connect the air unit, the DJI air unit, or the CADX air unit rather. Probably UART 5. So you'd probably see this. But on mine, let me see. Yeah, my receiver was already set up correctly, as mentioned. Serial RX on UART 1, that's SBUS. And that worked. Just as soon as I had bound my receiver, I had control over the quadcopter. So that worked out. And again, if you want to use a different kind of receiver like Crossfire, you'll have to change things in this screen. Now, you will, in fact, everybody will have to change the UART 2 GPS. That wasn't configured at all, weirdly. Now, Diatone actually did give me a reason, kind of, for this. They don't necessarily trust GPS in Betaflight, relying on GPS in... But that might be a little bit of... they might not be fully informed about it. They should, actually... right out of the box, at least configure GPS, just as you see it here. So I will be doing a short how-to video on GPS in general, but for this quadcopter, you'll have to set up on UART 2 GPS as a sensor input, so over here, and set the speed to 57600. So that's the speed at which the flight controller communicates with your GPS antenna. And maybe it would work on auto, but you'd be better off just setting it to 57600 and hit save and reboot. And for the rest, this screen is just fine. There are no other peripherals on this quadcopter you need to set up. Well, if you add things, you obviously do, but stock, this setup will work. Receiver and... Oh, smart audio was already set up. So control over your video transmitter on UART3, that was already set up correctly. So no changes there. Then on the configuration tab, let's have a look. Motor idle, that's the first thing I noticed, is 7, that's higher than stock Betaflight. I guess they had a reason for that, and I can imagine there being a reason for it. So that's one change from the stock Betaflight setup. And let me see, I changed the name over here. I'm not sure what it was, Diatone Roma or something. Well, personal thing, of course. The arming angle was already at 180 degrees, which is good. Obviously, the board alignment and stuff was already correct. And one thing of note, all the specifications, by the way, of the quadcopter are in the description of this video if you want to check those out. But I'm glad to see that this flight controller actually has onboard memory, as you can see over here. So if you want to do PID tuning, that'll come in handy. Or, well, fault finding, if something's wrong with your quadcopter, that memory is very handy to have. And let me see. So, yeah, SBUS, again, this was what it was like set up stock. And again, if you want to do Crossfire, you'll have to change that to Crossfire or anything else you want to change that to. But, with the XM Plus connected up, that worked out right away. So let me see, soft serial. I don't think this quadcopter will need soft serial. So you can switch that off. Telemetry, if you run Crossfire or DJI Digital, the Caddx Vista setup, you will want telemetry. I have the XM Plus receiver in my quadcopter, so I won't be using telemetry, obviously. So I will switch that off. And let me see, I will enable air mode, not needed. You can set that up as a flight mode. But yeah, I'd kind of say enable air mode always. And let me see. Yeah, they have actually, as you can see here, D-Shot beacon configuration. They have set up basically the motors to act as beepers, which is nice. And you'd have to switch both of these off if you add the included hardware buzzer. But stock, this is good. This is the right configuration they chose here. And there's one thing you need to change, whether you have the DJI digital version or the analog version. GPS over here was disabled. And again, that goes back to Daito not trusting GPS. Again, they should definitely have enabled this. So enable GPS over here, and let me see, it's a uBlox GPS receiver, and auto config is should be set to on, and ground systems assist type, I'm not sure, probably depends on where you live in the world, right? European EGNOS, I'm not sure if that's supported, I really don't know. But with the settings as you see it here, so GPS on, uBlox and auto config, this will work. And you can actually check if that works by connecting up a LiPo. Right now, over here, the GPS icon is disabled. And I am indoors, obviously, so I won't pick up a lot of signals, satellites, sorry. But I now have a LiPo hooked up, as you can see here, and the GPS icon has been enabled, which means, that means actually that the flight controller sees the GPS antenna. So it tries to communicate, talk to your GPS antenna, and it gets answers back that it expects. So yeah, again, I will do a short video on how to set up GPS, but this is really what you need to know for this specific quadcopter. This way it'll work. So this GPS on uBlox auto config and UART2 GPS sensor input 57600, and that's it. That'll give you a working GPS antenna or GPS setup. Also, if you want to check things, you will have to enable export mode on the top right of the Betaflight configurator, like so. That'll add GPS over here as a tab, as a configuration tab. And I actually see, the GPS receiver actually sees two satellites, as you can hopefully see here. That's not enough for a GPS fix, but that's, I'm indoors, right? I'd be hard pressed to see an actual GPS fix indoors. Some antenna will give me a GPS fix here, but most don't. And okay, so I'll remove my LiPo and let's have a look at the rest of our configuration. Failsafe. So yeah, the failsafe is still set to drop, which is common for all Betaflight configurations. Now, eventually, I will probably set that to GPS rescue, but if you want to go that route, first test fly your quadcopter, then test if your GPS configuration works correctly, gives you the right information in your OSD, for instance. Then maybe try GPS rescue on a switch to test it and quickly be able to disable it. Then, if all of those things work, then I'd say maybe enable GPS rescue, but definitely not as a first thing. If you get this quadcopter, take it out of the box, definitely don't go ahead and configure GPS and then enable GPS rescue, hoping that will work somehow. You definitely, and that's actually why Ditone was concerned about GPS, and they again are a little bit misinformed what Ditone thinks of. Their concern is that you would enable GPS rescue before you've tested everything. I hope that makes sense. Okay, let's have a look at the PID tuning. They have done some tuning, as you can clearly see from the sliders. They are not in their center row, they are not all at one. So they've done something, whatever that boils down to. And we'll see, I will be flying the quadcopter as is. Rates, I will probably increase the rates, that's a personal thing. And you should, in my humble opinion, add Expo. So I'll be adding Expo 0.35 on all axes. I've actually converted myself to using Expo. For the longest time, I didn't use Expo at all, but yeah, oh well. It'll definitely help you capture smooth video if you'd want to do that. So add some Expo. It'll make the quadcopter fly more smoothly. And okay, save. Filter. Okay. That is a little bit surprising, these filters. 0.9 and 1. Okay. Actually, I noticed that there are some harmonics vibrations in this frame, and I suspect that's true for most any of these LR4 frames. Thin arms, lightweight frames, they don't have enough mass weight to smother vibrations. So I think that's why they had to add a little bit more filtering. Okay. We will see, and you can actually go ahead and tune that to your liking, because again, this flight controller has onboard memory, yay, but we'll fly it as is. Okay, receiver, nothing set up over here. Yeah, I do actually have RSSI set up on AUX 12, I think. But, well, that depends on, first of all, your receiver, and second of all, the firmware on your receiver. So that's something you'll have to figure out yourself. And modes. Modes, okay, this is a bit sparse, to say the least. Only an army mode. This will work. It's set up on AUX 1, so your first switch, basically, and you don't need other flight modes, but I will be adding a couple flight modes. Just, well, personal preference, of course. And so again, you see this GPS rescue mode right over here. I will be adding that, and that's something I will be adding to test that GPS rescue mode. And I'll set that up on a separate switch. Then let's have a look at our OSD, the on-screen display. And okay, so they've definitely changed things from the stock setup. Stock beta flight setup. The name of the quadcopter is set to the top left, and I will be changing out things, but okay. Milliamp hour used in the top right corner. You've got a home direction arrow over here, so that depends on your GPS actually working, obviously. And I will be probably adding, for instance, speed just for the fun of it, right? But I do at least want to be able to check if the GPS setup does something in this screen. So let me see, where is that the GPS satellite count? GPS satellite count, SATS, over here, SATS. That's definitely something you want to add, so you can check if, again, your GPS setup does something. Okay, and I've added the FPV setup to your OSD, which is very nice. And I will be shoveling things around, but this looks just fine, and just simply add and subtract things to your liking, obviously. And that's basically the setup, the Betaflight setup. I want to give you one tip. Whenever you get any new quadcopter in, a ready-to-fly quadcopter, even a new quadcopter that you built yourself. Hook up that quadcopter to Betaflight with a USB cable. Then go to the CLI tab, bottom left corner over here. Type in diff double F space all double L, hit enter. And that'll give you a text reading of all the changes in the setup. All the settings your quadcopter needs. And save all that to a text file. Save to file in the bottom right corner. And as you can tell, I've already done so. This text file over here is the stock setup for this quadcopter. So whenever you screw things up on your quadcopter, you can always revert back to all the stock settings with that text file. Vital. So again, for any quadcopter you will ever have, the first thing you want to do is hook it up to Betaflight and save your stock setup this way. So diff all and export that to a text file. All right, and if you haven't fallen asleep yet, I'm sorry this video somehow became almost half an hour. What happened? We're going to be flying the quadcopter right now, right? So let's go out to the field and see if the quadcopter actually flies. So guys, line of sight test flight with the Diatone F4 Roma. In a minute we'll also do some FPV flying, of course. But first let's check it out. Line of sight test flight, here we go. I've got a tattoo. R-Line 850 milliamp hour 4S on it, which might not be the ideal LiPo, but it'll fly probably. Here we go. What's going on? Doesn't arm?
Arm motors.
Doesn't arm? Oh, maybe it would help to hook up the LiPo. Usually that makes quadcopter flying a lot more successful. Okay, take two, main flight with the Diatone F4 Roma.
Arm motors.
And now it does arm. And we are up and away. Yay! So you might have noticed that I could arm without waiting for GPS fix. And I forgot to tell you how that's done. I'll put up a picture of the bottom of the fail-safe screen. And in that screen you need to enable, I'm not completely sure what it's called, but well, it's on screen right now. And you need to enable being allowed to arm your quadcopter if there is no GPS fix. Okie dokie, back to flying this quadcopter. First thing I notice is that it's pretty quiet. You will probably be able to hear that it's pretty quiet. Now, for a quadcopter to be efficient, sound is energy waste, right? Well, waste. So an efficient quadcopter will always be more quiet than a non-efficient. Needless to say that it flies well, smoothly, and we'll be able to judge that more in the FPV flight. But pretty nice. So far, so good. I'm not completely sure if this LiPo is any good, by the way, but it's good enough for a line of sight test flight. I've got a couple of newer LiPos with me as well. Pretty nice. Again, smooth and pretty quiet. And I'm not sure if you'll be able to really see the quadcopter well. It's small and mostly black. That's why I'm keeping it close by. This is just a test flight, right? But no issues whatsoever so far. Very, very nice. Easy to keep off of the ground, so the throttle control, if you will, is it's not lacking in performance, at least not as much as I had expected.
This is definitely not a powerhouse. None of these LR4 quadcopters are powerhouses. But it's not bad, actually. It is windy. So far, so good on that side as well. I'm not really fighting the wind much at all, actually. So, yeah, it works. Punch out. Again, I'm not sure if this LiPo is any good, but let's see what the punch out looks like. Okay. Decent. Yeah, not... Again, not as bad as I had anticipated these quadcopters to be. And maybe this diatone version is a bit more peppy than the others, I'm not sure. The 401 ESC definitely is. 30 amp, I think, which is definitely more than most of the other LR4s. Oh, nice! Easily controllable, or easy to control, rather. Yeah, pretty nice. Okie dokie, enough of this line of sight mambo jambo. Let's do some FPV flying. Alrighty guys, made an FPV flight with the Diatone F4 Roma, and notice that I'm not waiting for a GPS fix. I'm anxious to fly it, and I've also noticed that waiting for a GPS fix takes quite a long time. Maybe in another video I'll be testing the quadcopter, obviously, after these maiden flights. I'll do a lot of flying with it so I can get back to you with a long-term review. Today I'm just gonna have a look at what the stock experience is like, what it flies like, findings. So far it is impressively smooth. Impressively smooth, yeah. I do expect to try some different propellers, maybe three-bladed propellers on the quadcopter as well. That 4-in-1 ESC should be able to handle that. Yeah, so long range means nothing to me. I'm not interested in going long range. Endurance, sure. It has become more windy, by the way. I can now see that I do have to fight the wind. So for me, this is again more of an endurance class of quadcopters, but maybe also long race. Let that sink in, long race. You might have noticed that all of these LR4 quadcopters are very similar. The specs are very similar. Low weight, 1404 motors. A lot of them run on the same propellers. You could see these as a racing class. If I were to race you, and you'd have the Gap RC or the Flywoo version, the performance of the quadcopter should be similar. So the racing would be down to our skill. And I very much hope that you'll be able to actually hear me still, because it's become very, very windy. I still do not have a single GPS inside. Maybe that won't work when I'm flying, who knows. I'll be a little more patient on my further testing with the quadcopter. Today I simply want to know if it flies well. And it's very windy, but I can definitely control the quadcopter. I can sense the wind. I haven't tried a power loop yet. There's nothing really to power loop here, but... Hot damn, what was that? not sure what that was. Maybe, I don't know. That was a little weird. It actually sounded as if the propellers clipped, which is something these thin propellers do. Okay. That definitely needs more testing. That was a really weird power loop. The quadcopter didn't freak out after it had that twitch. That definitely looked weird. Okay, so what camera is this? This is a Runcam Nano 2. The colors are, with the sun in my back, like so, are a bit oversaturated. Flying into the sun, actually okay. And I can still see where I'm going, flying straight into the sun, which is nice. Definitely not a camera I need to instantly replace. So that's nice. Okie dokie, so yeah, far windier than I had hoped for. This is the first sunny day in a while, so I definitely wanted to do some flying with the quadcopter. Yeah, nice so far, apart from that twitch, and I have no idea what that twitch was. Maybe the propeller hit my balance lead? No, that can't be the power leads. Okay, other than that, things look fine. And you tell me what you think. I don't see any need to do tuning right out of back. And maybe I'll add an action camera to the quadcopter, I really don't know. Okie dokie man, successful, and this video is already far longer than it should be. So I'll be testing the quadcopter further in the coming week or weeks, and then I'll come back to you with my findings on this Diatone Aroma F4. For now, I want to thank you for watching. If you are left with questions, hit me up a comment down below. Catch you on the next video. Bye bye.